Bucky Brooks, former NFL defensive back, former NFL scout, Seahawks, Panthers. So, Combine's interesting. I was much more into it years ago. I think it, here's what concerns me is you're not getting an authentic experience, is that kids now prep for it. A kid who may not have a great work ethic knows if he works out for 8 to 10 weeks, gets in the best shape of his life, he can make a lot of money. So I do think Belichick, Sean McVay, Matt LaFleur, increasingly I'm seeing coaches saying, hey, I'm going to watch a lot of game tape. I'm going to trust my scouts. I feel like there's a little bit of a movement. People are concerned that it's become a cottage industry to coach players up for the combine. Is that fair?
Yeah, some of that is fair. Yeah, because the players have been exposed to these drills. Because you got to remember, this generation of players, they grew up watching the combine on TV. It's not the mystery that it once was. Hey, I'm going to go to Indianapolis. I don't know what I'm going to be asked to do. How am I going to do it? Et cetera. Well, now they know all the drills. They know what to do. They know how to prepare for them. And so if you come in great shape, you've repped the drills, you absolutely can ace them. There's still value to the combine in terms of watching guys work out, for instance, watching the quarterbacks throw back to back to back, watching the wide receivers run routes after one another. It helps you kind of like set your order because you're seeing them do similar things instead of recalling what someone did at one pro day versus another pro day. So there's value to it. But I think in the end, Colin, what you're learning from the coaches, hey man, the tape trumps everything.
Sure.
And even though you have a remarkable workout, we're going to make these decisions based off how you played in college more so than how you work out in front of all these people in your shorts and your t-shirt.
You know, I said this as when I saw C.J. Stroud for Ohio State against Georgia run, it was Justin Herbert against Wisconsin in the Rose Bowl, is that their coach protected them, and I saw them as overwhelmingly pocket quarterbacks who threw accurately. Little mechanical, but clearly size, arm, accuracy, NFL quarterbacks. And then Herbert is allowed to run against Wisconsin, and it's, oh, I get that too. And I saw C.J. Stroud against Georgia, and I'm like, I didn't know that. And I kind of feel like we're sleeping on C.J. Stroud. He's like Herbert, quiet, says the right stuff, doesn't have a huge arm, but just like productive, accurate. Now, Herbert does have a very good arm. Are we sleeping on C.J. Stroud?
Yes, 100%. He is the most natural passer in the draft. He's the number one quarterback that I have based on what you've always graded quarterbacks on. Prototypical size, dimension, arm talent, the way that he plays the game. This guy is what you look for. He's a franchise quarterback that has played in this league for the last 50 years. Much like your comparison to Justin Herbert, I believe Ohio State protected C.J. Stroud in the same way. When Justin Herbert was coming out, I asked Mario Cristobal, why didn't you run him? He said, we didn't have a backup quarterback. I didn't want to put him out there. We lose him, and now our chances of playing at a high level dissipates. Same thing for Ohio State. You protect him throughout the regular season. You let him do most of his work from the pocket. But when it came down to the playoffs, they unleashed him, and you saw a guy who really displayed everything that you look for in today's game at that position. This dude here is QB1. He is the one that we're going to talk about down the line being the superstar of this group.
Yeah, no, it's the Georgia game was an eye-opener, as was the Wisconsin game for Herbert. So I don't do mock drafts because I'm wrong enough. I don't want to be more wrong. But your mock draft, actually, I think there's an argument it makes perfect sense. So you go, you have Chicago taking Jalen Carter, who I think's a more dominant player at his position than Will Anderson. I do. That's the quarterback rankings for Bucky. Let's go to his mock draft. You have Houston taking Bryce Young. I think he's very good, especially in a warm weather or a dome situation. You have Arizona going with an edge rusher they need. Indy gets C.J. Stroud. I could see that happening. And Seattle getting an edge rusher. Let me ask you this about Seattle, though. You were a scout for the Seahawks, and you know Pete Carroll. He loves unique athletes. D.K. Metcalf, I'll take him. Lanky, long Richard Sherman, I'll take him. Extraordinarily huge safety Cam Chancellor, I'll take him. Percy Harvin couldn't stay on the field, migraines, I'll take him. Pete's history as a teacher, as a molder Bucky, tells me Richardson, the quarterback at Florida, I mean, he's like, he's got a lot of Cam there. He's raw, But could you see Pete, who you know, just saying, I'm taking the best athlete and I'll show him how to play football?
Pete Carroll has the luxury of being able to make that pick because he has a veteran quarterback in place in Geno Smith. Geno Smith buys Pete Carroll time to develop Anthony Richardson. Now, I understand the comparison to Cam Newton. Cam Newton was a more dominant player in college than Anthony Richardson. That said, someone who is 240 pounds that can run 4.4, that can jump out the building and do all those remarkable things, man, that's what you want at the position. That said, it has to be a situation because he only has 13 starts. You have to give him time. Remember, the last guys that we've seen picked at the top of the board that had few starts, they haven't gone well. Mitchell Trubisky, Trey Lance. And so if you pick Carroll, this is part of a long developmental plan. Hey, guys, do not ask me about Anthony Richardson for the next 2 years. He is going into a developmental plan. We're going to work him out. And then in 2 years, 2025, that might be the time where we begin to see him, because Geno Smith would be at the end of that second year of this new extension. Now might be the time to hand the ball to Anthony Richardson if you're the Seattle Seahawks. It has to be a team with two first-round picks. It also needs to be a team that has a veteran in place that can run the team for the next year or two while this guy gets ready.
Okay, you tell me, if the Jets, what would you as a Green Bay Packer executive? Let me ask you this, Jets. You want Aaron Rodgers. What would you give Green Bay? He's going to be 39. He's been semi-committed. There's a story today by Mike Silver that the Packers felt Aaron, once he got the bag, checked out. What would you give for Aaron Rodgers, knowing he talks retirement two or three times a year?
You can't give him a first-round pick. You cannot give up a first-round pick.
Wow.
Because you just don't know how long he's going to play. I mean, Aaron Rodgers, look, he's been year to year the last few years. And I know people like to look back at those shiny MVP awards when he went back to back. But last year, he was a different player. He wasn't a great Aaron Rodgers. And so if you're the Jets, what you're hoping is, look, he can turn back the clock for once, help us get over the top, maybe be someone who can model how you want to play for Zach Wilson. But you can't think that this is going to be longer than a two-year run. So how many assets am I willing to give for that? I'm not willing to necessarily mortgage the farm for Aaron Rodgers at 39 years old, knowing he may give me 1 or 2 years. That's not enough for me to give up a first-round pick.
Oh, look at Jason McIntyre. He just loves what you're saying.
Thank you, Bucky. Good stuff.
Okay, I'm going to throw you my crazy theory. That general, a lot of owners in pro football and pro basketball and pro baseball, Major League Baseball, they're not in it to win championships. It's a toy. It's a business. Similarly, a lot of GMs don't do what's always best for the franchise. They protect their butt. Chicago, you know this, could get additional picks for the number one pick. They may not get a one. They may not get a two. But if I'm Chicago, Ryan Poles, and I'm like, listen, there's three defensive ends I like, and they're all, it's inches, not feet. The Clemson guy, the Bama guy, they're going to both be nice NFL players. And you just start calling teams, Houston, Indy, Carolina, what will you give me? And let's say the best thing you get is a fourth round pick. Well, the Bears have 9 spot. They need starters. They need capital. Why? You know the Bears can get something for it, but you've been in those rooms. Are GMs afraid to look bad to other GMs? Because, you know, if your owner supports it and you only get a fourth round pick, it's still a potential starter for the Bears, is it not?
It is, but you got to be careful. Number one overall pick, you want to get someone that is a gold jacket worthy player. And if you're going to trade out of that, you want to get enough to make sure that you bring currency to really upgrade the team. A fourth round pick is not going to be enough for me to move out the number one spot. It's just not going to be enough because on paper it looks bad. And the player that you're getting by draft grades, you're talking about a developmental player. We talk about starters. This league primarily is a first, second-round league. I know you're seeing guys that make plays from outside of that, but it's really about hitting on your first two picks, making sure that you get starters and guys that can form the core of your team. And so if you're Ryan Poles, you want to make sure that you bring it back. But in actuality, the reason that people want to move up to number one is typically to get a transcendent
quarterback. That's right.
And I think what you're hearing and what the lack of movement so far, I don't know if anyone views any of these guys as transcendent generational talents. That's why it hasn't necessarily been the buzz, and that's also why Ryan Poles has been trying to drum up interest to get people up there. If this was Justin Herbert at the top of the board, then people are like, hey, whatever you want, I'm willing to give up. It's not that kind of quarterback class, which is why it hasn't drawn that kind of interest.
Yeah, it is interesting, but if you think there are three defensive ends in the first 12 picks that you like, that's where I'd be willing to move to 8 for a third-round pick and just say, we don't see a huge gap between Clemson guy and Bama guy. Well, there is no Chase Young.
There is no Chase Young in that. And so Ryan Poles has kind of let it out when he said, hey, I think there may be 7 guys worthy of being taken number one.
Right.
What he's saying is, I don't necessarily see a great player, but I see a bunch of really good players that we'll be happy to have. And so if someone wants to come up here and swap out, we'll move down, and maybe we won't move down lower than 8. He's kind of letting people know how far he's willing to drop. And so those teams, he's saying, hey, if you want one of these quarterbacks, you need to come up here, and I'm willing to go back to, what, the Raiders are 7?
Yeah.
I'm willing to go back to maybe the Falcons at 8.
Yeah.
So it's available. I'm letting you know you can come and get it.
There you go.
Now, show me your best offer.
All right. So you're all right. That explains it. All right. Bucky Brooks, great stuff. Fox Sports Radio, my friend. You know I love the combine work you do and the insight you provide. I appreciate it. Thanks. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.